morning, students. I am Dr. Vishal Mandlewala, assistant professor in orthopedic department. The topic for today is frozen shoulder, tennis elbow, golfer's elbow, and torticollis. First of all, we'll start with frozen shoulder. What is frozen shoulder? Frozen shoulder is defined as the gluteofemoral joint with pain and stiffness that cannot be explained on the basis of joint incongruity. Also known as adhesive capsulitis, as the pathology involves the capsule of the joint. Seen in women more commonly than in men during the 5th to 7th decade. Bilateral involvement occurs in 10 to 40% of cases, does not usually occur in the same shoulder. However, 20 to 30% develop the condition in the opposite shoulder. Etiopathogenesis. It are mainly of two types, the primary frozen shoulder and the secondary frozen shoulder. Primary frozen shoulder, there will be no inciting event, normal plane radiograph, and no finding other than loss of motion. In secondary frozen shoulder, the precipitate traumatic event. Primary frozen shoulder, there will be the intrinsic factors like the age between 40 and 60 years of age. Mostly, the patient will be suffering from diabetes mellitus. The extrinsic factors may include immobilization and faulty body mechanics. We should understand that in frozen shoulder, the first movement of the loss will be the external rotation of your forearm. You won't be able to do this. If you are able to do external rotation and if you are able to move your hand in abduction passively, if you are able to move it more, it cannot be frozen shoulder, it will be because of rotator cuff tear. In frozen shoulder, you cannot manipulate the range of movement. The pathology, the landmark evaluated the shoulder capsule of 14 patients. Histology showed increase in fibrous tissue, fibroblasts, and vascularity. There are mainly three stages of frozen shoulder according to Hanafin. Phase 1, there will be pain, decreased range of movement. In phase 2, there decreased range of movement. While phase 3, mild pain and marked lower range of movement. Phase 1, the arthroscopic vascular synovitis will be diffused. Same in phase 2 and phase 3, minimal synovitis. The arthroscopic stages of frozen shoulder. In stage 1, there will be lower lying fibrous synovitis, no capsular contracture. Into increased synovitis with fibrous adhesion and capsular contracture. In 3, subsiding synovitis and increased capsular contracture. And in 4, only capsular contracture, no intra-articular process. The treatment for stage 1 will be only physical therapy, while in 2, physical therapy then manipulation, 3, physical therapy and manipulation, same as 4. What can lead to secondary frozen shoulder? Mainly because of rotator cuff disease that I explained before, fracture acidulus, calcific tendinitis, previous shoulder surgery, osteoarthritis, cervical spine lesions, autoimmune disease, chest wall tumors, thyroid disorder, Parkinson's disease, CVA, head injury, and myocardial infarction. The clinical features consist of 3 phases in any case of primary frozen shoulder. The secondary frozen shoulder may not follow the same chronology. The 3 stages include pain, stiffness, and thawing, also known as freezing frozen and thawing stages. Here you can see the inflammatory, freezing, frozen, and thawing phases. The painful phase will usually last for 2 to 9 months. There will be incident onset of pain with progressive loss of motion. Phase 2, there is stiffening, 4 to 12 months. Pain with progressive loss of motion, there will be muscle atrophy. Muscle atrophy should always be kept in mind because that will lead to muscle stiffness, and also because of muscle atrophy, there will be weakness of your muscles and the patient will not be able to lift the arm. Thawing, the pain subsides, the pain motion gradually returns after 1 to 3 years. In phase 1, the incident onset of pain, more at night affecting sleep, distributed vaguely over the deltoid muscle area. Only point of tenderness is the bicipital groove. Upper backache due to compensatory use of shoulder girdle muscles. There is in phase 2 stiffness, there is a protective muscle spasm is a common feature. May prefer wearing a sling to support the arm. Function activities such as dressing or grooming, which require reaching over or behind the back, may be difficult. Loss of range of movement is the most prominent one, just pain has subsided. Empty and free at the range of motion, internal motion is loss initially followed by loss of flexion and external rotation. Terminally painful passive range of motion, which I explained it earlier. Limitation of passive range of movement shows a capsular pattern, that is external rotation more than abduction, more than internal rotation. External rotation less than 45 degrees, abduction less than 80 degrees, and internal rotation less than 70 degrees. Phase 3 thawing. As the motion increases, the pain diminishes, usually occur spontaneously over 4 to 9 months, even without any treatment. May not regain full range of motion, but may feel normal as a result of compensatory mechanism and adjustment in activities of daily living. How will we diagnose? The clinical diagnosis describes three features to diagnose the frozen shoulder. The internal rotation is restricted up to the point when the patient cannot touch beyond this sacrum. 50% loss of external rotation, less than 90 degree of abduction. However, this criteria are not definitive, and presence of all three is not mandatory. Investigation, the X-ray, it will mostly be normal. However, it can be used to rule out other conditions. Commonly revealed conditions such as osteoporosis, degenerative condition, decreased space between acromion and humeral head, calcium deposit, and cystic changes. The arthrography can either be done fluoroscopically or with the help of MRI. 50% reduction in joint fluid volume. Joint volume capacity is only 5 to 10 milliliter. The tight thickened capsule, loss of axillary recess, subcoracoid folds and subscapular bursa, and the absence of dye in the biceps tendon sheath. C, which I described earlier, you can see in a normal radiograph, there will be joints, fluid will be there. But if you see in frozen shoulder, there is a clearly lack of joint fluid, which can clearly demonstrate that, okay, that the capsule is there and the fluid is slightly decreased. The same is shown over here. The normal, you see, the normal axillary recess, there is a quite fluid amount of fluid is there, but in the absence of axillary recess. Treatment. Although the frozen shoulder is self-limiting condition, it imposes such morbidity and lengthy recovery time that patient and clinically seek treatment intervention. No standard treatment regimen, however, is accepted universally. Conservative treatment is the mainstay of therapy, and only refractory cases are subjected to operative intervention. Modulators, that is oral analgesics, salicyclates, NSAIDs, and codeine compounds help to reduce the pain and inflammation in the early stages. Medical practice are referred to intra-articular injection of steroid, accompanied by local analgesics and gentle active motion in the freezing stage of frozen shoulder. The intra-articular steroid. Hollingworth reported the injection of corticosteroid directly into the anatomical side of the lesion produced pain relief in at least 50% improvement in the range of movement and 26% of the cases studied. Bingley stated that they may reduce the pain if administered in conjunction with manipulation. In summary, the local corticosteroid injection have been used with various results, but generally they produce the greater gain in motion recovery if used in combination with exercise and heat therapy. Physiotherapy. The role of physiotherapist is before resorting to passive mobilization, the thick and contracted capsule must be released and made more stretchable by deep heating using ultrasonic suitable modalities. Heating can be carried out by passive physiological exercise and accessory exercise. Phase 1 of physiotherapy, used when the patient had a painful movement. The physical therapist will apply accessory movement in the comfortable joint position with the affected arm supported in loose back position. The therapist administers slow, gentle oscillatory movements in the anterior, posterior and cephalocaudalate direction if they do not increase pain and induce muscle spasm. The therapist provides a mechanical block to movement short of the painful, restricted range, and continues to use gentle, low amplitude oscillation. Here you can see in the figure the gentle cephalate caudalate motion, short of pain and motion restriction used to treat patient. Phase 2 physiotherapy used to treat a stiff joint. As this condition progresses, The therapist may detect stiffness before or concurrently with the onset of pain. The therapist then should begin low amplitude physiotherapy in accessory oscillation at the time of restriction. To increase abduction, the therapist with quadric light performs more powerful oscillation at the end of accessory range. Here you can see the quadric light mobilization at the end of restriction, accessory motion used to treat stiffness. The role of the patient is very important. In frozen shoulder, if you think that the only physiotherapist will help, it doesn't work like that. Patient himself has to do physiotherapy and include the physiotherapy in the daily routine activities. Such as the pendulum exercises, the forward stooping position with one hand resting on a table or a chair, the patient gradually swings the arm like a pendulum and later carries out the circumduction movement 5 times daily in 5 to 10 minutes sessions. You can see the figure over here. Patient is bending down and keeping the arm forwards the hanging position and he moves in a pendulum fashion. The shoulder elevation exercise with normal head supporting the affected one, the shoulder is gradually lifted to position of flexion, abduction and external rotation. Hand to back position, patient carries the arm backward with the shoulder in a position of extension and adduction. The figures explain this in a very beautiful way. The shoulder will exercise to be done by patient himself at the physiotherapy center. Pulley exercises, which can be done by the patient himself at home. The figure here easily demonstrates, is very easy to understand this and can be applied at home very easily. Manipulation, the close manipulation of the shoulder under general anesthesia, reserved for patients who have failed to gain range of movement after physiotherapy and local injection. Also recommended in patient who refuse to wait for long for resolution of symptoms. Significant improvement is seen in around 70% of patients. But you have to be very, very careful while doing manipulation. Sometimes while doing manipulation, it can also lead to fracture of shoulder. So it should only be done under general anesthesia and should never be attempted to do at home or in OPD. It should always be done under general anesthesia in OT and very careful. The doctor should be very careful by manipulating. The complications of manipulation, the proximal humeral fracture, as I described before, the shoulder dislocation, fracture dislocation, rotator cuff ruptures, flexion nerve injury. This can be avoided by gentle, slow manipulation if a firm endpoint to motion is well. Further manipulation should not be attempted. The last option is surgery, that is arthroscopic release of frozen shoulder. Now we'll go to our next topic, that is torticollis. What is torticollis? The torticollis is also known as the wry neck. It is a dystonic condition defined by abnormal asymmetrical head or neck position which may due to variety of causes. The term torticollis means twisted neck or collar neck from the Latin words. Classification, non-paroxysmal, that include congenital, muscular, osseous, CNS, PNS, ocular, non-muscular, soft tissue, paroxysmal, spasmodic syndrome, increased ICP and conversion disorder. Types of torticollis, there are temporary torticollis, fixed torticollis, muscular torticollis, Klippel-Feil syndrome, cervical dystonia, congenital torticollis and acquired torticollis. Temporary torticollis. This type of torticollis disappears in 2 days. The most common causes of this is due to swollen lymph nodes, ear infection, cold or even soft tissue injury. Fixed torticollis is also known as the permanent torticollis. It usually relates to some muscle or bony structure. Muscular torticollis is the most common type of torticollis. It results from scarring of tight muscles on one side of the neck. Klippel-Feil syndrome is a rare congenital form of wry neck. It occurs when the bone in your baby's neck form incorrectly and notably due to two neck vertebrae being fused together. This is known as Klippel-Feil syndrome. The two vertebrae are shown in the X-ray that they are fused together. Cervical dystonia, the rare condition is referred as spasmodic torticollis. It causes the neck muscles to contract in spasm. If you have cervical dystonia, your head twists or turns painfully to one side. It may also tilt forward or backward. Congenital torticollis is rare, less than 2%, and is believed to be caused by local trauma to the soft tissue of the neck just before or during delivery. The most common explanation involves the birth trauma to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, resulting in fibrosis, or that intrauterine malpositioning leads to unilateral shortening of sternocleidomastoid. See, you can see the contracted muscle. The figure they are showing, there is a sternocleidomastoid muscle. Acquired torticollis is defined as a condition where it is due to inflammation of the cervical muscles or cervical nerve from different processes. Acute torticollis can be result due to blind trauma to hair or neck or simply sleeping in the awkward position. Symptoms: inability to move your head normally, neck pain or stiffness, headache, having one shoulder higher than the other, swollen neck muscles and tilt of chin to one side. Investigations are done in the case of congenital torticollis to confirm the infant has torticollis or not by doing the necessary investigation, that is X-ray or MRI. The medical management: the muscle relaxants medication, which can be treated the tremors of Parkinson's disease, botulinum toxic injections for a few months and pain medications. The surgical management will be done by fusing abnormal vertebra, lengthening of neck muscles, cutting nerve or muscles, using DBS to interrupt nerve signals. Use only in severe cases of cervical dystonia. Physiotherapy management is very important, and normally most of the patients recover by physiotherapy if it is presented early and it is diagnosed early. Physiotherapy management actually based on patient impairment can be modified to meet the patient's requirement. Heat therapy, stretching, strengthening of muscles of the opposite side affected will bring more benefit. Exercises for improving balance, coordination can be introduced. I conclude my torticollis topic, and we should now move to our next topic, that is medial epicondylitis. What is medial epicondylitis? Medial epicondylitis is also known as the golfer's elbow. It's a condition generally characterized by pain in the elbow. If not treated immediately, the symptoms associated with this condition can be debilitating and may even prevent you from going to work or taking part in activities that you usually enjoy. The difference between tennis elbow and the medial epicondylitis, as golfer's elbow, is very rare. The treatment and the symptoms normally of both the disease are very similar, and the treatment for both the disease are also similar. So first we'll also understand what is tennis elbow. Tennis elbow is a term condition used for the overuse of arm, forearm and hand muscles that result in elbow pain. You can see here, Mamdadiri is a very good example playing tennis. But the tennis elbow, as it is known, as people generally understand, only those people who are playing tennis will be suffering from tennis elbow. Students, that is not true. Any overuse of your elbow can lead to tennis elbow, because it involves the area where the muscles and tendons of the forearm attach to the outside bone area of the elbow. You don't have to play tennis. It can favor sportsmen who have tennis elbow, as Sachin Tendulkar, Stuart Clark, and Jim Vanek, there is tennis pro. Causes of tennis elbow: as I said earlier, the repeated same motion over and over again, like making rolls of chapati, playing a racket sport such as tennis or badminton, carrying heavy loads, 20 hours at computer each week for many years. Minute tears in the arm muscles and tendon can cause inflammation. What are the symptoms? Pain slowly increases around the outside of elbow. Less often, pain may develop suddenly. can see in tennis elbow, the plane is in the outside of the elbow. While in golfer's elbow, the plane is in the inside of the elbow. Pain is worse when shaking hands and squeezing objects. Pain is made more worse with stabilizing or moving the wrist with force. Now, you also need to understand, while playing tennis, your hand is in full extension. So, the extensor muscles get involved. While in golf, if you play, your flexor muscles get involved. The test to diagnose, there will be no blood test, X-ray will diagnose, clinical test, there is Posen test, and Mills test. Treatment, conservative, mainly to avoid activities which still strain on extensor muscles of forearm, like wrist extensor movement, NSAIDs, localized fomentation, tennis elbow, belt. Local steroids can also be tried along with lidocaine, with aseptic precautions can be given to decrease pain and local inflammation. Physiotherapy plays a very important role in the treatment of tennis elbow and golfer's elbow. The goal is to strengthen muscle, tendon, and to enhance repair of torn tendons. It is recommended when only pain is bearable or less for wrist range of movement, wrist stretching exercises as shown in the figure, pronation and supination of the forearm, elbow range of movement, wrist flexion exercises, the wrist extension exercises, wrist radial deviation strengthening, forearm pronation and supination strengthening, and wrist extension with groom. It should always be followed in this order. You cannot start the wrist extension with groom handle and first, because that will lead to more pain. Result advances as shown, but it's quite controversial. The platelet-rich plasma, also known as PRP, plasma of the same patient can be centrifuged and injected locally. Some studies proven better, but same technique not good results in tendo Achilles rupture. Surgical treatment is only given when all the conservative treatment have failed. But it is very, very rare that you will require to do a surgical intervention. Most of the patients of tennis and golfer's elbow recover mostly by physiotherapy, by tennis elbow belt, or if it requires, then you can inject the corticosteroid injection or PRP. Thank you, students. Here I conclude my lecture. Thank you very much.